Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. This is The House of Law and I am attorney Aljo Marani. This is episode 7 of Civil Law Jurisprudence by Justice Leonen. If you missed the 6th episode, you can watch it through the link above or the link in the description box below. In this episode, I will talk about 3 more Supreme Court decisions penned by Justice Marvick Leonen. The first case is about the right of a legitimate child to use the surname of his mother instead of that of his father. The second case is about recognition of foreign divorce. And the third case is about an as-is where is sale. So let's begin. Our first case is Alanis versus Court of Appeals, GR number 216425, November 11, 2020. So in this case, Alanis was born Anacleto Balyaho Alanis to Mario Alanis and Jarmila Balyaho. Growing up, however, Alanis had been using the name Abdulhamid Balyaho because his parents, although married, separated when he was still 5 years old. Apparently, Alanis adopted a Muslim name because his mother was Muslim. He had been using the said name in his public and private records. Thus, he filed this petition to change his name to Abdulhamid Balyaho. The regional trial court, however, denied the petition on the ground that, being the legitimate child of Mario Alanis and Jarmila Balyaho, he should be using the surname of his father. Also, the court suggested that Alanis should just change the name in his public and private records to conform to the name in his birth certificate. So, the issue in this case is whether a legitimate child may change his name so that he can use the mother's surname instead of the father's surname. Here, the Supreme Court held that while Article 364 of the Civil Code provides that legitimate and legitimated children shall principally use the surname of the father, principally does not mean exclusively. This gives ample room to incorporate into Article 364 the state policy of ensuring the fundamental equality of women and men before the law. Be that as it may, the request for a change of name must be grounded on any of the following instances. Number one, when the name is ridiculous, dishonorable, or extremely difficult to write or pronounce. Number two, when the change results as a legal consequence of legitimation or adoption. Number three, when the change will avoid confusion. Number four, when one has continuously used and been known since childhood by a Filipino name and was unaware of alien parentage. Number five, when the change is based on a sincere desire to adopt a Filipino name to erase signs of former alienage, all in good faith and without prejudice to anybody, and when the surname causes embarrassment and there is no showing that the desired change of name was for a fraudulent purpose or that the change of name would prejudice public interest. So, in this case, the request for change of name was justified. Alanis had been using the name Abdulhamid Balyaho since he was young, as in fact, his name and private records bear the said name. Changing his name now will prevent any confusion later on. So now you know that a legitimate child may use the surname of the mother because the law does not say that it should be exclusively the surname of the father that should be adopted by the child. The second case is Arreza versus Toyo, GR number 213198, July 1, 2019. Here, Genevieve Arreza was married to Tetsushi Toyo in 1991 in Quezon City. 19 years later, the two filed a divorce in Japan. Genevieve then filed a petition before the regional trial court for the recognition of foreign divorce and declaration of capacity to remarry. During the trial, she presented authenticated copies of the divorce certificate, notification of divorce, Toyo's family register, and a private English translation of the Civil Code of Japan. The trial court here in the Philippines, however, denied the petition. It decreed that while the pieces of evidence presented by Genevieve proved that their divorce agreement was accepted by the local government of Japan, she nevertheless failed to prove the copy of Japan's law. Genevieve appealed to the Court of Appeals to no avail. So she went up to the Supreme Court claiming that the English translation of the Japan Civil Code is an official publication that was a self-authenticating document. To this, the Supreme Court ruled that the foreign spouse's national law was not sufficiently established. First, it reiterated that in actions involving the recognition of a foreign divorce judgment, it is indispensable that the petitioner prove not only the foreign judgment granting the divorce, but also the alien spouse's national law. both the foreign divorce decree and the foreign spouse's national law can be established by complying with Rule 132, Sections 24 and 25 of the Rules of Court. Under Sections 24 and 25 of Rule 132, a writing or document may be proved as a public or official record of a foreign country by either an official publication or a copy thereof attested by the officer having legal custody of the document. If the record is not kept in the Philippines, such copy must be accompanied by a certificate issued by the proper diplomatic or consular officer in the Philippine Foreign Service stationed in that foreign country in which the record is kept and authenticated by the seal of his office. Here, the English translation submitted by Genevieve was published by Abun Horeisha Incorporated, a private company in Japan engaged in publishing English translation of Japanese laws. It was not an official publication exempted from the requirement of authentication. However, the silver lining in this case was that the case was remanded to the Court of Appeals for reception of evidence of the foreign spouse's law. Kaya may chance pa si ate mo. Our third and last case for this episode is Poole-Blunden versus Union Bank, GR number 205838, November 29, 2017. In this case, Poole-Blunden purchased on public auction a condominium unit in Makati City which Union Bank acquired through foreclosure proceedings. The unit was advertised to have an area of 95 square meters. After delivery of the unit, Poole-Blunden started improving and refurbishing it. However, he observed that it was kind of small, so he hired a geodetic engineer who found that the unit only measured 74.4 square meters. Poole-Blunden then informed Union Bank, but the bank said that the 95 square meters included the terrace and the common area surrounding it. Poole-Blunden naturally did not accept the explanation and demanded a full refund of what he had paid. When Union Bank refused, Poole-Blunden filed a complaint for rescission. Both the trial court and the Court of Appeals dismissed Poole-Blunden's complaint. Particularly, the Court of Appeals held that the sale was an as-is-where-is sale per the contract of sale, and that Poole-Blunden supposedly waived any errors in the bounds or descriptions of the unit. So the issue in this case is whether the sale is an as-is-where-is sale, which cannot be rescinded. To this, the Supreme Court held that Poole-Blunden is entitled to rescission. First, the Supreme Court emphasized that under Republic Act No. 4726 or the Condominium Act, a unit is reckoned by its bounds. The areas of common use are not part of the unit. Thus, there was causal fraud when Union Bank advertised the unit to have an area of 95 square meters when in fact the usable area was only 74.4 square meters. Next, as to the claim that it was an as-is-where-is sale, this type of sale pertains solely to the physical condition of the thing sold and not to its legal situation. Features that may be physical but which can only be revealed after examination by persons with technical competence cannot be covered by as-is-where-is stipulations. A buyer cannot be considered to have agreed to take possession of the things sold in the condition where they are found and from the place where they are located if the critical defect is one which he or she cannot even readily sense. Here, Poole-Blunden could not have waived his right to the actual area of the property because that can only be ascertained after examination by someone equipped with peculiar skills and training to measure real property, like the geodetic engineer which he hired. Alright guys, those are the three cases for this episode, and that caps episode 7 of Civil Law Jurisprudence by Justice Leonen. I hope may natutunan kayo today. For the bar reviewees, take note of these cases, baka lumabas sa bar exams this November. Please drop a like if you like this video, please subscribe to support me, and click that notification bell to be alerted when I upload a new video. So, till next video, laging tatandaan, isip ay buksan, alamin ang batas. Bye guys!